I think everybody has arrived. Thank you for waiting so patiently. Welcome. And thank you for joining us for the sixth of our Torah Fund Stands with Israel series. I'm Barbara Ezring, the International Chair of Torah Fund. Since 1942, Torah Fund has been the designated philanthropy of Women's League for Conservative Judaism. We are so proud to celebrate the 80th anniversary of Torah Fund. Before we begin, we have muted everyone so that we will all be able to hear our presenters without any background noise. We have disabled the chat. However, if you have questions, you may send them via chat to Madeline Gimbel. At the end of our presentations, we will take questions. And at that time, you may also click on reactions and click raise your hand. It is my honor to acknowledge Women's League for Conservative Judaism, International President, Debbie Kaner-Golditch, and to welcome our past international presidents of Women's League and past international Torah Fund chairs who are in attendance this evening. Also participating tonight are Madeline Gimbel and Janet Kirshner, International Torah Fund Vice Chairs. Torah Fund supports programs and scholarships for students at the five global institutes of higher learning of the conservative Masorti movement, including the Jewish Theological Seminary in New York, Ziegler School of Rabbinic Studies in Los Angeles, Schechter Institutes of Jewish Studies in Jerusalem, Seminario Rabbinico Latinoamericano in Buenos Aires, and Zacharias Frankel College in Potsdam, Germany. Thanks to the generosity of donors for eight decades, we have raised over $109 million. We are unusual in that our dedicated fundraisers are all volunteers from Women's League affiliates of conservative synagogues throughout the US and Canada. Funds raised support important educational initiatives and special education projects for the training of our future rabbis, cantors, teachers, scholars, and Jewish community leaders. Thousands of committed Torah Fund donors help strengthen and ensure the future of the Jewish people worldwide. We invite you to donate to Torah Fund by clicking on the link that will be provided in the chat. Torah Fund is hosted by the Jewish Theological Seminary, where Torah Fund staff members administer the philanthropy's outreach, engagement, promotion, donation, and data processing activities in tandem with the wide network of Torah Fund volunteers. We're excited to present this series in support of Israel. We hope you will find it informative and educational.
It is my honor to introduce Rabbi Shaul Peretz. In her role as Associate Dean of the Ziegler School of Rabbinic Studies, and also at Zacharias Frankel College, Rabbi Shaul Peretz teaches, counsels, advises, and manages programs. She has served as a pulpit rabbi at Sinai Temple and Adat Shalom in Los Angeles, at Temple Emmanuel in Burbank, and in guest positions in Florida, California, Illinois, and Texas. She teaches study groups, adult education, Talmud classes, and at scholar-in-residence programs worldwide. A graduate of the double degree program at Barnard College and the Jewish Theological Seminary with degrees in mathematics and Jewish philosophy, Rabbi Peretz also earned an MBA degree from Baruch College and has extensive corporate professional expertise. Rabbi Peretz.
Thank you so much. Hi, everyone. It's wonderful to be with you. One of the things that I think Zoom has opened up for us is that we are constantly in each other's homes. And as we think about the home of Israel that is so dear to us, I wanted to really invite you into my home, but the only way to do that is through a picture. I wish I could have you all here. So I want to share with you, this is the picture that is in the center of my living room. And this picture is actually called Yerushalayim Shel Mala and Yerushalayim Shel Mata. It's the Jerusalem of high and the Jerusalem of low. And this picture has always been such an inspiring reminder for me of keeping my heart and my head and my efforts focused towards Israel and towards Jerusalem. But it's all been work though now. And I think as an interpreter of art and based on the name, I need to invite you into that. Because if you notice, the top and the bottom, you'll see the line across the middle, the top and the bottom on one hand look almost identical. It looks like the absolute mirror image. But if you look a little bit more carefully, you'll notice that the sequence of colors or the size or the shape or the orders of the buildings look just a little bit different. And for me, that has become really instructive in reminding myself of what it means to think about Yerushalayim Shalmala, the Jerusalem of high and the Jerusalem of low, or the Jerusalem, which in the rabbinic world means the Jerusalem of the divine sphere or of our dream, and the Jerusalem, the Israel of reality. And I know I'm going to stop sharing now, but if you could just paint a picture in your mind of this, I know that you, like I, are so conscious of the dream and the miracle that is the state of Israel, that is represented in the land and the people and the culture and the self-determination that Jews have in having our own country after thousands of years of struggle. And I also suspect that you, like I, are also struggling with some of what we hear in today's world about what's happening on the ground. You can unfortunately pick from amongst the long list of concerns to have, whether it's about egalitarianism and what happens at the Kotel, or just the way in which women in the society are treated, whether it's about the overall judicial reform and democracy, or if it's about religious tolerance, if it's about the news of the last several days of the threat from Gaza and the dispute, there's much to worry about. And yet I find myself through all of that, remembering that I don't know a Judaism without Israel any more than I know a Judaism without Shabbat, without Kashrut, without prayer, without home celebrations. It's deeply ingrained into who I am, into who we are as Jews. And I want us to just think for a moment about the original proclamation of the state in 1948, in which Menachem Begin called for a land that was based on justice and equality and religious freedom. And he said in his remarks that day, he said, "And within the homeland, justice shall be the supreme ruler, the ruler over all rulers. There must be no tyranny. The ministers and officials must be the servants of the nation and not their masters. There must be no exploitation. There must be no man within our country, be he citizen or foreigner, compelled to go hungry, to want for a roof over his head, or to lack elementary education. Remember," he says, "you were strangers in the land of Egypt, as the Torah said. Its supreme rule must continually light our way in our relations with the strangers within our gates. Righteousness, righteousness, tzedek, 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 righteousness, righteousness shall you pursue, will be the guiding principle in our relations amongst ourselves." These Torah values, in which he drew from ancient text for a contemporary meaning, were to be the guiding post and the guiding light for what it meant to build the country of our dreams, the country of the Jerusalem of Ai, the Jerusalem we pray for, the Jerusalem the prophet so beautifully kept articulating for us, and even the Jerusalem that was promised to our ancestors after the wandering in the desert. And this year, just a couple of weeks ago on Yom HaAtzma'ut, I was teaching the insert of the paragraph for the Amidah for Yom HaAtzma'ut, which is begins Al HaNisim Ve'al HaPorkan, on the miracles and the wonders and the big moments on which this event took place, and then goes on to give, like the paragraph for Purim and like the paragraph for Hanukkah, mention of some of the battles that have taken place amongst people to get us there. And one of the people in my class at the time raised his hand. He said, I don't understand how it is we can say that when it sounds like you're saying all this was brought upon by God. But in reality, we know that human beings were just as actively involved in the modern state of Israel, maybe even more so. And what does that mean about what's happening in the country today? Are you simply saying that that means that God brought this all on? And what I want to offer us is really what I've been thinking about and what I think it takes to really think about Israel today, which is that there are miracles from God. And the fact that we have the land and the culture and the self-determination is an incredible blessing. And imagine the many, many miracles that had to take place in order for that to happen. I'm reminded of what Einstein taught us, which is you can live your life as if nothing is a miracle or as if everything is a miracle. And I think what is so important is that in the moment of our prayer, we are really aspiring for the Jerusalem of high. And we aim really high, and we understand that we can't do it alone any more than any of our ancestors could, even Moses himself. And so in that moment of prayer, which is a moment of encounter with God, it's fitting that we allow ourselves to consider the many miracles, to consider the hand of God in what has become the greatest miracle for the Jewish people, at least in this, you know, these last several centuries, perhaps I would say even more so. And yet, we come out of the Amidah and we're faced with the reality that we're not yet there. And in fact, the divide sometimes feels like it's getting wider between American Jews and Israelis. But what never ceases in the heart of the Jew is, I believe, embodied most beautifully in the words of Hatikva, right? As long as in the heart within a Jewish soul still yearns, and onwards towards the end of the East, an eye still gazes toward Zion, our hope is not lost, the hope 2,000 years old, to be a free nation in our land, the land of Zion and Jerusalem. You may never have looked at the words of Hatikva, though we all learn them as children, but that's what we're saying. The words of Hatikva remind me that no matter what in life, but certainly no matter what in modern Jerusalem of this world, we can never give up hope, which means that we can, as we come out of that prayer, we also can never give up the willingness to fight for that ability to bring Yerushalayim Shalmala and Yerushalayim Shalmata a little bit closer together, so that next time you come into my house and you look at that picture, you'll actually see the direct reflection and not an almost reflection. And so I want to bless us all with the continued strength and hope to believe in miracle, to believe in the miracle that is modern Israel, and for the willingness to fight for that miracle every single day.
Thank you, Rabbi Peretz, for the thought-provoking Dvar Torah. I am Madeline Gimbel, and I have the pleasure of introducing our guest speaker, Tal Itzhakov. who is the cultural and press attaché at the Embassy of Israel in Mexico. Tal has a degree in special education and mathematical education and a teaching certification from Oranim College of Education. She joined the Israeli Ministry of Foreign Affairs in March 2020, and since September 2020 has served in her current role. Previously, she worked at the Afula Municipality as the Higher Education Coordinator of the Chesedim National Program, which increases access to higher education for Israelis in the geographical and social peripheries. She also served as the Israel Community Emissary of the Jewish Agency for the Pensacola Jewish Federation. Tal is fluent in Hebrew, English, and Spanish. Tal Itzhakov.
Shalom, everyone. Thank you so much for this opportunity. Thank you, Rabbi, for the Dvar Torah, and thank you, all of you. I'm very honored to be here. So my name is Tal Itzhakov. I'm 32 years old. I've been here in Mexico already 2 years and 8 months. And to me, to be a diplomat and to be able to represent my country is the biggest dream and goal I could ever ask for. But I didn't know I wanted to become a diplomat all my life. So actually, as you mentioned, I learned special ed and mathematics. In my military service, I served as a soldier teacher. I worked with kids from underprivileged backgrounds. And then immediately after I finished my military service, I started my studies. And then I was a teacher in a school in Afula, my hometown in the Jazul Valley in the north of Israel. But then I felt very curious about the opportunities that the Jewish Agency has to offer. And I decided to go on a mission in the Pensacola Jewish Federation, what for me really was a life-changing experience. I can tell you that during this year in Pensacola, in my shlichut, I was able to learn more about Israel and Judaism than ever before. In the first time of my life, I understand that to be Jewish is not something you take for granted. You know, in Israel, many times with no efforts, you feel Jewish, all your atmosphere, all your culture, and you don't really think about it or the different streams of Judaism, the conservative Judaism, the Reform Judaism. And the big opportunity to be exposed for that was really life-changing. I remember when I first got back from Pensacola, the Jewish Agency, the direction there asked us, how would you define your time in the US in 7 words? So I said, the smartest decision I have ever made. And this is the truth. And in my first time in life, I could feel what does it mean to represent my country. I learned so much about Israel and I could understand better who I am. And when I came back to Israel, I felt that I want to be much more involved in my community in Afula. So then I became the higher education coordinator. So Afula is considered to be the periphery of Israel, a part of that. And many young adults don't have a lot of opportunities. So what I've been doing during more than 3 years is to work with these young adults to increase their awareness to the importance of high education as mean of social mobility. And while I was doing it, it is interesting, but I could understand better what I want to do for the rest of my life. Every meeting like that with a young adult in my city was another mirror to myself. And then I started to connect so many dots. When I was a child, I was always so curious about other cultures. I thought myself Spanish. My Spanish is fluent. I also studied Arabic when I was in school. I was always attracted to this kind of things, but I couldn't understand it until I had this journey with myself. And then I decided to apply for the Israeli Ministry of Foreign Affairs. It took a whole year of application. And then I started the cadet course. And after half a year, they sent me to my first post here in Mexico. I can tell you that this journey of getting to know better who I am and what I want to do in life is one of the turning points of my life. And I feel really, really proud. I'm serving here by myself. I have no partner yet to share with them these experiences. And even in my hardest days here, I can remember and hold in my head and in my heart that I'm just in the right place for me. Thank you so much for having me here today. And I'll be happy to show you the rest of the presentation. So we are already in ceasefire, but we felt it important to speak a little bit of what was happening in Israel in these last days. So the Palestinian Islamic Jihad is one of the Iranian proxy organizations. As we know, Iran is promoting and financing and directing terrorism all over the world, and the Islamic Jihad and Hamas is their proxies. They lately, in the last months, they were trying to violate stability all the time by firing rockets over Israel from the Gaza Strip and by encouraging terror and terror attacks inside Israel. The turning point was May 2nd. A Palestinian prisoner who is a member of the Islamic Jihad, which was in the Israeli prison, went on a hunger strike. He did it a lot of times before, and he decided to do it once again, demanding his release from prison. According to a court decision, they told him that he cannot do it and we cannot release him from prison. And he refused to receive any medical assistance until he died in prison. Right afterwards, the Islamic Jihad fired over 100 rockets on the civilian population in Israel. And then Israel decided to launch an operation. This operation lasted 5 days. We were trying to eliminate a few leaders of this organization, of the terror organization, in order to avoid harm to Israeli civilians. I can tell you that during all this operation, almost 1,500 rockets have been fired on Israeli population. Unfortunately, 20% of these rockets fell in the Gaza Strip. And I think this is our biggest problem, the fact that they are using the citizens of Gaza as human shields. And they're doing a double crime, a double war crime. On one hand, they're firing at a civilian population in Israel. But on the other hand, they're doing it from the civilian population in Gaza. You can see in this picture a young child who unfortunately is trained to fire rockets on Israel. Israel is not against the citizens of Gaza. More than that, we think they're the first victims of this terror organization. But we are trying to do all our best in order to minimize harm to civilians inside Gaza. But we have to do all we can in order to protect the security of our citizens. We have no interest in escalation, but we need to ensure the safety of all Israeli citizens. I will tell you a little bit about the Israeli-Mexico relations. So, in last 1st of July, we celebrated 70 years of diplomatic relations, which is a really big event and very exciting one. Despite the geographical distance, our ties are very strong. During the years, we had a lot of reciprocal high-ranking visits, of ministries of tourism, agriculture, technology. In 2017, the Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu visited for the first time Mexico. Then the president of Back Times, Shimon Peres, came to Mexico as well. And then the Mexican president Enrique Peña Nieto came to Israel for the funeral of Shimon Peres. We also had a lot of cooperation agreements in the fields of culture, academy, research, and the most important one is the free trade agreement that got into force in 2000. I can tell you that since then, the commercial exchanges increased dramatically. In 1999, it was about $210 million. And in 2022, it was already $1 billion. Actually, Israel is the first commercial partner of Mexico in the Middle East. There are a lot of Israeli companies who are working here in Mexico, such as Netafim, the irrigation and solution in terms of water and agriculture. In 1985 and 2017, in the earthquakes that happened in Mexico, Israel immediately sent some aid assistance in order to assist with disaster relief, some delegations. I can tell you the delegation of 2017 was during the Rosh Hashanah, the high holidays in Israel. Mashav is our international cooperation agency, like USAID. So during the years, we had a lot of activities here in Mexico with the aim of train the trainers in terms of women empowerment, agriculture, water management. In the COVID times, we even donate medical equipment here in Mexico to the different states. We even cooperated last year. I've been to Quintana Roo, to a pueblo, to a little village in Quintana Roo, together with USAID. We had a common activity here in Quintana Roo. We cooperated Israel and US here in Mexico. We can see a great interest in the Israeli culture as well. There are 32 states here in the Mexican Federation, which creates a lot of opportunities for cultural cooperations. And we can see a lot of interest from all the different sectors. In 2013, we were a guest of honor in the FIL, which is the largest book fair here in Guadalajara, which is the largest book fair in Latin America and the second largest in the world. And we had a huge delegation coming here together with the president Shimon Peres to inaugurate the Israeli pavilion. Then in 2019, we were a guest of honor in the film festival in Monterrey in north of Mexico. And then in 2021, we were a guest of honor in the Mix Festival in Mexico City, which is a LGBT film festival here. It's impossible to talk about the relations between Israel and Mexico without mentioning the great Jewish community of Mexico. One of the most impressive I've ever met. They are very dedicated, very organized, very Zionist, are in really good connections and collaboration with the Israeli embassy here. And we all always say that they are really a bridge, a cultural bridge in the relations between Israel and Mexico. And we are very grateful for that. So a little bit about the Jewish community here. The first presence of Jews here in Mexico comes back to 1519 with crypto Jews that came with Hernán Cortés from Spain. Later on, after Mexico became independent, immigrants arrived from Europe, the Balkans, Syria, and the US. The communities here are organized according to the countries of origin. And we can tell that from immigrants really that were welcomed here with open arms. The Jewish community became citizens involved in all aspects, in politics, the economy, the media, arts, in everything. Most of the community live in Mexico City. There are about 45,000 people, or between 45 to 50,000. And it is very active. Just for you to understand, there are 13 Jewish schools, more than 95% from the community, from the students in the community study in a Jewish school. There are 56 women voluntary organizations in all sectors, hospitals, education, and many others. There are 60 worship places and dozens of other community organizations. It is really, really impressive. The Central Committee is the representative institution of the Jewish community. In Spanish, we say the Comité Central. Their role here is to integrate into the Mexican life. They are in really good connections with the government, with authorities, in all levels, in the federal level, in the municipal level, in the state level. They are enhancing and maintaining this relationship all the time with all parties, if they're in the government right now or not, and with the media, the press, and it is really impressive to see it. As an evidence to that, you can see in this picture, we can see here the former president of the Jewish community of the Comité Central in the annual ceremony in the Senate of the Republic, to commemorate the International Holocaust Day, remembers Holocaust Day in January 27th. Usually the Senate is making this ceremony, and then they're inviting the president of the Jewish community together with the Israeli ambassador, the Polish ambassador, and the German ambassador. If you can please go to the next one. Thank you. So in this last 1st of July, we celebrated 70 years of diplomatic relations. We had a whole series of events. Actually, we are still doing some events until this coming June of 2023. I'll show you just a few examples. So you can see in the underneath of the page, a logo. We created this logo together with the Mexican embassy in Israel. This logo reflects the deep historical and cultural roots of each country, the Star of David, Magen David, together with the Quetzalcoatl, which is a Mexican historical symbol. We have created a common stamp. We also did Israel Fashion Mexico, a fashion desfile here in Mexico. Three Israeli designers cooperated with three Mexican designers, and together they showed their collections to a whole diverse public of academics and reporters and government members, and obviously members of the Jewish community. We also had a philharmonic event, a philharmonic concert. A Mexican musician collaborated with an Israeli musician in the Bellas Artes, which is the most important cultural venue in the Mexican Federation. We also, in the last picture, you can see an exhibition we created of the most important moments in these 7 decades of bilateral relations. Here you can see the ambassador of Israel to the UN, Gilad Erdan, in the inauguration ceremony here in Mexico City, points on the photo that shows the free trade agreement, the signing of the free trade agreement. We also had in this event a cooperation between a Mexican band and an Israeli band who played together a song in Hebrew and Spanish, created especially for this event. And these are just a few examples. As part of this celebration, and really because of our good connections with the Jewish community here, we encourage the Jewish communities and all the Jewish organizations here to take part in this celebration and to create their own events in the mark of 70 years. And I can show you an example of what the community of Bet El here in Mexico did. They did a kululam to Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, Jerusalem of Gold, in Spanish and Hebrew, with a special musical arrangement created for this event. Thank you so much, Corinne. And it's just important to say that also participated people outside of the community, not just from the Jewish community. Thank you so much for listening, for having me here today.
Thank you, Tal Itzhakov, and especially for enlightening us to the Jewish relationship of Mexico and Israel. We'll take questions.
You can put your questions in the chat, or you can click on reactions and then click on raise hand. Okay, here's the first, here's a question. Can we share that video? And yes, I would love for Rabbi Peretz to be able to hear it because it was really quite impressive. So we will try to see if we can get the link so that everybody can listen to that. Okay, May.
Mute me. Okay, good. Are the services in Mexico City in Ladino or Hebrew?
They're in both Spanish and Hebrew.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Lori?
Thank you. I was wondering about the women's groups in the Mexican Jewish community. We're big believers in egalitarianism, and I have no feel for how that is in the Mexican Jewish community. Do the women have a part in the, or are there organizations doing work outside the synagogue or within the community?
Thank you, Lori. There are a lot of organizations here that are doing a lot of different things. Some of them are volunteering inside the Jewish community, such as Yad Lakala, to help brides that have no money in order to make their event, as an example. But some of them are volunteering outside of the community. For example, in healthcare services, centers or social centers, and they have a really big role here. I can say this is really organized in terms they have their president, they have their vice president, they have elections every 2 years. So they have a really big role here. And I think in general, the Mexican society is much more open to that too, even here in the Jewish community. Now the president of the Keren Ayesod here is a woman for the first time in history.
Thank you.
I hope I answered your question.
Well, I sort of asked a couple different things. I was asking about, I guess if the Jewish community there is egalitarian, like the conservative movement here, do the women take part in the services? Can they have aliyahs?
Okay, so there are different streams here in Mexico. There are conservative reform, but also many Orthodox congregations. So it is very diverse. Okay. I can tell that the majority is Orthodox.
Okay.
Orthodox.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I just noticed that the link that whoever was asking for is on the chat. And if you wish to copy that, it's there. We have a question from Marilyn Cohen. Is there much anti-Semitism on the university campuses in Mexico as there is in our United States campuses?
No, so definitely this is not on the same level. We can see it less here. Sometimes we do see now a seminar of such a university, but we cannot compare that. Definitely we cannot compare that. And I can tell that the Jewish community here also is working for that. They're monitoring all the time the press, the media, the tendencies in order to find out what is next and to try to speak whoever is necessary in order to avoid that. So it exists. It's not like there is no of this phenomenon here, but it's not so popular. I can even tell you that lately I had a meeting with one of the private universities here, and the rector told to the ambassador and me that they have zero tolerance to this kind of things, so which was very great to hear.
I have a couple of statements here that have been sent to me. Harriet Meyer said she was in Mexico City years ago during Purim, and they went to services that sounded just like in the United States until they finished reading from the Megillah, and then they couldn't understand what was being said. A question, how is the Jewish community faring in Mexico currently?
They're what, excuse me?
How are they doing? How is the Jewish community doing in Mexico currently?
In terms of what, I mean, which is...
Cheryl, you want to ask the question yourself? Cheryl Wasserman, you there? There she is.
Okay, hi. Thank you for your very interesting talk. I was surprised to hear 1519, that the Jews started coming to Mexico. And I've learned many years ago that there's a very large Jewish community in Mexico. And I wanted to know how they were doing. One issue was discrimination, which you've already answered, but in terms of are they positive about Mexico and their future there? Are they thriving socioeconomically and with their identity? Are they large enough to support the young people finding their mates there, or are people leaving and departing? So that's what I meant by the question, a general question. Sorry. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yes, they are totally involved here in Mexico. They feel very comfortable here. And as I said, they have the Comité Central, the Central Committee, that is the formal representative in front of the authorities. And they have a really unique status, considering their opinions. They are very involved in all needed, even in discrimination, not related to Judaism. I mean, in general, here in the country, in many initiatives, with all sectors, which I think it's really important. They have a really good status here in these terms. And they also feel very comfortable with Mexico. I mean, it is really amazing to see how, from one hand, they feel very connected to Israel, very Zionist, very connected, very involved in their Jewish life and with their connection to Israel. Actually, every young adult, every student who finished the high school is going to what they call achshara in Israel, half a year, at least half a year in Israel, in different programs of Masa and others. It is very common. I barely know someone here in Mexico who didn't visit Israel or lived there at least a few months. This is on one hand. On the other hand, then they come back to Mexico and they're very satisfied from their life and they feel very comfortable and they feel Mexican. And I think that this video that we just saw, it's a reflection of that, that they are very proud to be Mexican, of all the aspects of the Mexican tradition and culture, but they keep their Jewish identity in the same time.
Okay, I have a question from Deborah Alden or Aiden, I can't read that. Can you tell us about the JCC in Mexico City?
There is something called, like a center called Centro Deportivo Israelita, as the cultural center and the sports centers and the social center of the Jewish community that serves as a whole community. It's like a community of itself. Many members here of the Jewish community, I think more than 10,000 or even more, are active members in the CDI, and then they take their children for different workshops there and activities and different activities. So it is a large, large center. Even during COVID, they created sort of hospital there for members from the Jewish community.
Thank you. I have a couple of personal questions. When you arrived in Mexico, it was the height of the pandemic and shutdowns were everywhere. How did this affect your work at the embassy?
Thank you for the question. This is a really interesting one. So that is true. When I first got here, when a diplomat gets to another country, he needs to learn everything, the culture, the language, to get to know the people. And it was harder to do it during COVID. I mean, I couldn't go out as much. All my first meetings with reporters or other partners were in Zoom. So it is funny because later on I saw them, these people, in some other events, and I couldn't recognize this is the one I was doing the Zoom with. This is on one hand, and I can tell you that we worked in the embassy in capsules. I mean, we didn't work physically every day in person. So this was also a part here of this difficulty, because I didn't get to know all the workers in the embassy in the beginning. But this is something all world experience, and it was very unique too, because we could create some different things, Zoom meetings, conferences. We also had press conferences to reporters here in Mexico, which was very interesting to do it with experts from Israel. When we had a vaccination campaign in Israel, so we used some specialists from Israel in order to tell Israeli the best practices of Israel here in Mexico. So we also use this in order to enhance our relations and the exchanges of practices. And I think it brought like another experience, which will be very useful for the future as well, because now I think we have some more flexibility. We can think, okay, it's not like we cannot do it. We can do it under different circumstances or different. So I think this is a gift too, not just disadvantage.
And a final question was, how long will you remain in Mexico?
Yes, so I'll be here a few months more. And actually I just 2 weeks ago got my new post as the spokesperson of Israel in Spain. So I'll be moving to Spain, to Madrid in September, and I'm very excited for that. I'm very sad to leave Mexico. I already feel like a half a Mexican here with all what I've experienced during my time here. And, you know, I speak 100% of the time I speak Spanish. I even now in Hebrew, I'm mixing words in Spanish. And I'm very grateful, and all what I experienced with the Jewish community, like really, I'm very honored to be here. But on the other end, I'm very excited for my new adventure and to getting to know a new culture and new people and to be meaningful in another place in this world.
Thank you.
And I see May, you have your hand up. Go ahead, May.
In the Mexican Jewish population, what is the rate of intermarriage? Is it a big thing or?
Yeah. So as I said, the majority of the community is Orthodox.
Right.
So I know it exists, but not as much. As far as I know, it exists in scale of 1 or 2%, and that's it. The vast majority of the community
is Orthodox. Okay.
And I can tell you, I mean, the community there also is very, in certain terms, is more closed in some terms.
Insular, I mean, yeah.
Yeah, like many young adults getting married here very early. I mean, the age of 23 or 24. So they're really trying to keep it. And in general, as I said, there is a whole Jewish system here of 13 Jewish schools. And I can see the difference between, for example, when I was in Pensacola, there were no Jewish school. There was just yes. Sunday school. And then the parents and the children had to do some compromises in order to attend this Jewish school. And they need to give up the baseball game with all the students in his class, just in order to participate in Jewish school. And here it's something that is very, it's much more easy to do. And this is why I think it makes easier the marriages.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wait, there's somebody just sent another. Hold on. Is the Jewish community rather wealthy? Are there any poor Jewish Mexicans?
There are. They are not the majority, but there are. And this is as part of the women voluntary organizations. There are a lot of organizations who are helping to this poor as well. As I mentioned, Yad Lakala, for example, for women who want to get married and need to have some economic help in order to be able to do it. So it exists. It's not the majority, but it exists.
And
I will just add that in this regard, there are scholarships for students in the Jewish schools as well.
That's good.
That's good.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Are there kosher restaurants, and is it easy to eat kosher in Mexico?
And what is the last one?
Kosher.
Is it easy to keep kosher?
Okay. Very easy to keep kosher. I can tell you that where I live. So there are neighbors in which it is much common than others, obviously, but I can tell you in my neighborhood in Polanco, I have for at least 4 stores near to my home in which I can buy everything kosher. And more than that, I have another supermarket, City Market, right next to my home, which is not a kosher supermarket, but they have a whole section of kosher meat, fresh kosher meat every day. So it is really easier than what I thought. I come from a traditional family, so to me it was something very important, the kosher, and it is very easy to do it here. I couldn't imagine and understand how much easy it will be.
Okay, so for some of us who don't live in areas in the United States or Canada where it's easy, you can try out Mexico.
And the big majority of the Jewish community of Mexico lives here in Mexico City, which is easier, right? The majority are here. But comparing to some other small communities in Guadalajara or Monterrey, it's not as easy as here. They are smallest communities.
Madeline, did you find another? You have some more questions? You're muted.
I said I do, but the time is fighting you. Does the Jewish community work with the general population in things like hunger?
Things like what? Sorry?
Hunger. When you're hungry to eat.
In what? Sorry?
Food. Hungry. To be hungry when you need to eat.
Does the Jewish community work with the general population on helping people to get food who don't have food to eat?
Yes. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned before, like social centers, and they're helping all the time with all needed. There is a Chesed centers here. Actually, we just collaborated with one of them in the mark of 75 years of independence of Israel. We just did a collaboration. They're involved, the Jewish community, in all aspects, with hospitals, with social centers, etc.
Okay, thank you so much. I want to thank Rabbi Peretz, and I want to thank you, Tal, for such beautiful presentations tonight. I know that we've all learned a lot. And Mexico is our neighbor, so the relations between Jewish Mexicans and Jewish people from North America, from the United States and Canada, are very important. So thank you very much for being with us tonight.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm honored to be here with you. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to thank some of the women who worked behind the scenes to bring this program to fruition. I want to thank Lisa Paul, the Torah Fund Director, Rabbi Ellen Wolens Fields, Women's League for Conservative Judaism Executive Director, and Karen Bellina, Women's League's Member Relations Manager. And a very special thank you to Karen for your tech support and for hosting Zoom tonight. I want to thank everybody for your support of Israel and for your support of Torah Fund, and enjoy the rest of your evening.